Hello, my name is Dustin Phipps. I'm a pre-medical student at the University of Houston and a native Houstonian. I've been working with Occupy Houston since its initial planning stages, therefore I feel I have a good grasp of its direction. I'd like to state as a disclaimer that I'm not a leader of this movement, nor can I represent it as such. May I continue?
Please.
Okay. I would like to thank City Special Events, HPD, and Parks and Recreation for their cooperative and compassionate disposition towards us throughout this process so far. That being said, the options presented to us for the allowance of tents and other structures to protect ourselves, medical supplies, food, and equipment have been cost prohibitive. Therefore, I'd like to call on the City of Houston respectfully to assist us in bringing a successful resolution to this problem. Thank you very much. Also, I'd like to see a Kroger in the third ward. That'd be awesome.
Councilmember Jones is not here.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Raffi Wakefield. I'm like Dustin and many other people here from Occupy Houston, but once again, I do not represent Occupy Houston officially. I'm here speaking as a private citizen. We at Occupy Houston have been confronted with the reality that the occupations across the country are experiencing as well. People, mostly men, without shelter, are joining us in greater numbers every week. I say with a great sense of shame for this city that most of the people who slept in Tranquility Park last night had no choice about sleeping outside. One of the realities of living outdoors is a tremendous legal oppression. With the recent expansion of the boundaries affected by the civility ordinance, Houston sent a message that its solution to a citywide homelessness problem is to force the most defenseless people in our society to stay out of sight of the wealthy. That issue extends to the matter of tents. I realize that tents in public parks and public sidewalks and public places are unsightly. But for many Houstonians, tents would be a significant quality of life improvement. I realize also that the City Council does not bear the full responsibility for our city's widespread homeless population. But I'm asking you to turn your minds to the fact that at this moment, thousands of people in the city are without homes, often physically ill, mostly with substance abuse problems or mental illness, that the city does not predict economic improvement for years, and that the private charities which feed and heal the homeless are being regularly overwhelmed. I also ask you to remember that this past August, when every day topped 100 degrees, under these conditions, we can't be surprised when some desperate people will commit crimes to get some kind of shelter. With those things in mind, I am asking you to fully fund a program with a plan to provide mental health services, temporary shelter, drug treatment, and health care to reduce the city's homeless population over the next 5 years. Secondly, I'm asking you to take immediate action. Stop criminalizing homelessness, repeal all civility ordinances, make camping in public parks legal, and acknowledge that these people exist. Provide public bathrooms or at least porta potties for them to do their business in. That's all I have to say. I hope you'll take this problem issue very seriously, because I do now.
To be clear, you're with Occupy Houston?
Yes.
And your objection is to the fact that the homeless people are also in the park with you?
No. I'm not objecting to their presence. I'm saying that being at Occupy Houston has made me aware of their presence, how prevalent the problem is, and it's also made me aware of the fact that they are facing serious legal obstacles just to living there and being homeless.
And you are aware that there are a number of agencies and institutions directed toward serving the homeless and providing shelter, although there are rules or requirements to access that shelter. And many of the homeless, for various reasons, are unwilling or unable to follow the rules of those shelters.
Again, I realize that even if we had unlimited resources, the homeless problem could not be solved tomorrow because many of them have mental illness problems, many have substance abuse problems, and so on. I'm asking for a long-term view to reducing the homeless population.
I'm actually committed to that and have been meeting with federal agencies on that and hope after the first of the year to be able to do something along those lines, although I don't think allowing tent encampments for the homeless is the proper way to go. But thank you for raising the issue with me. There are a number of council members who have questions or comments. Councilmember Jones.
Mr. Wakefield, I agree with you. Let me be clear. I'm the chair of the Housing and Community Development Committee. If every agency that we have in the city to help with homelessness open their door, which they do open their doors, we don't have enough housing for the homeless. People are turned away every night including at Bread of Life, not everyone who's homeless has a substance abuse problem or has mental illness. We had a gentleman at the Housing Committee meeting last Thursday who came and said that he was turned away from housing, and because he wasn't mentally ill or had substance abuse. He got turned away because he was a man who just happened to be homeless. And they told him that if he had kids, you know, it'd be better. So I do not live under the impression that if people are homeless, there's something wrong with them. This is a very difficult economic time. We have new types of homeless people. We had Coalition for the Homeless and a number of other organizations that deal with homelessness come and speak at the Housing Committee meeting and explain, and we don't have sufficient permanent housing for the homeless with support services. So those same people came and explained shared how many homeless children there are in school. So I'm thankful that people who had no awareness of the homeless problem are now becoming aware of the homeless problem because of these times, because it's not going to go away. And I believe there's enough blame to go around rather than blaming the victim, me personally. And I think that we've just got to do a better job in government of addressing the issues, because we are criminalizing homelessness. I am not a big proponent of civility ordinances. I've said it to council, I'm not saying anything new. I believe there's nothing civil about civility ordinances, because the question becomes, if everyone decides that they don't want homeless people around them, you know, where are we going to push them to? We're going to say Houston's not welcoming of everyone, and then we've got this don't give food to the homeless. If I see a homeless mom and kid out there and they need food, I'm going to give them food. I've been hungry before. Believe me, my only meal was when I went to school, and that was my meal for the day. So I think there are a lot of people who don't appreciate homelessness because they've not been homeless. And just makes me really sad. Just makes me really sad. But thank you.
Councilmember Gonzalez.
Sir, thank you for being here today and for raising attention to this issue. Just a couple thoughts. One is I would also urge you to seek out the state legislators as well. We've had a lot of cuts in the mental health sector, and as you know, our jails have become our mental hospitals of today, and we need to build in some more treatment.
Thank you. We don't have enough.
Sure, we don't have enough to extend.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You do.
I'm sorry, we do.
Motion to extend.
Yeah. Discussion, favoring, opposed, motion carries.
So again, I would urge you to continue to seek also your awareness in those areas as well. One thing that I'm really trying to advocate for is every year through the city we arrest thousands through our public intoxication, Class C type low-level offenses that are really shouldn't be criminalized. I think that we could do a better job of creating some type of detox sobriety center, which I know that we have some support for, and it would provide a point of access. So instead of just incarcerating those low-level offenses, not while they're driving, I'm just saying being publicly intoxicated, that we could provide that point of access, try to give them some opportunities at least for some recovery services, and to try to improve their quality of life and also lower our cost as well. So I think it makes sense. So that's something that I'm really pushing for. So thank you very much.
Councilmember Adams.
Thank you, Mayor. First of all, I just want to thank everyone for coming down and voicing their opinions within the last couple of weeks, making your voices heard. And as a council, we appreciate that. But one of the things that I just want to just commend you on, we're coming down and just challenging council to do better. But one thing that I can say, and I can vouch for the administration and the mayor on this, and she and I have already had a conversation about having a strategic plan on how we move forward with the initiative of homelessness. And she's already worked out her plan. I know starting January, she has already brought in the partnership to see what we need to do, the state coalition for the homeless search, and worked on ways that we can improve. One thing that I can say is that I'm the type of person that's going to put my money where my mouth is, you know, just not a talker but a doer. Since 1992, I've worked with homeless issues from juveniles to adults, men and women coming out of the prison system. Worked with MHMRA for over 6.5 years. So homelessness is a top priority of mine. A year and a half ago, I had the opportunity to find out, what about funding? What is it? What is it that we're not doing correctly on our homeless issue? So I took the initiative. You all stayed out for the last, a council member slept on the streets for 13 hours just to see how the process works. And it was sad to hear just recently the Bread of Life lost, I think they said, about a third of their funding. And so it's sad. If they lost a third, then I mean other homeless organizations lost a third as well. So we all have to do our part. Maybe some reshifting needs to take place from funding that's coming from the state. We really need to look at it. So with this, the mayor, that is really a top priority of mine, and I just want to publicly commend her for already working on the issue. I think we talked about it about a month ago, about the strategic plan and how do we move forward. If you all have any ideas before you leave, we welcome them on how do we move forward, because it's an issue for everybody. And I just want to commend this administration on thinking ahead and really saying what her number one priority, starting in January, neighborhoods, and that includes our homeless population. So I commend this administration for looking in it and starting early, and I look forward to her rollout of her initiative come January. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilmember. Thank you.
Thank you all for your consideration.
Thank you, Mayor and Council, for your attention to the people's requests today. Houston, like many municipalities across the country, are suffering from wasted war, the huge disparity of wages and our unemployment, indeed our economic and greed crisis that threaten our fiscal stability and our quality of life. Since October 6, Occupy Houston has engaged in peaceful protests from the City Hall lawn, graciously trekked over to Eleanor Tinsley Park, and now squished up at Tranquility Park. I propose that HPD not rigidly enforce and hassle every little doodad ordinance. A few tents, signage, some curfew, porta potties, littering. Figure out what you're going to do to permit and get this secured and do some compromises. I don't have time to sing you a song today, but I have enjoyed teaching and sharing some songs with the young people at Occupy Houston. Songs that move people to take risks, be courageous, be of faith, speaking out, standing up. You know, we shall not be moved, and we shall overcome, and this land is your land, and wade in the water, and stand with me, I will stand with you. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. This little light of mine. You get it. I brought some song sheets to give to those. If you raise your hand, I'll give them to you. In the declaration of the occupancy of Wall Street, there's a lot of grievances. You don't have to agree with all the grievances. Go to OccupyWallStreet.org. I'll give you a whole list if you want. But just let us grieve. Let us speak and camp out. I'm not occupying overnight, okay? I'm not sleeping on the concrete, buggy ground with a tent and or anything. You've been there? You done that? Mm-hmm. Well, it's their turn. It's the young people's turn. Let them do it. You know, they're learning from the homeless. Do you hear that? They're not blocking doors to the City Hall. They're not sleeping in the halls of the Federal Reserve Building. Or they're not preventing business as usual at the big banks downtown, though that could be arranged. I want you to figure out acceptable compromises. Will you consult with, I'm bringing you a list, Los Angeles, Des Moines, New York, Charlottesville, ordinary cities of how other councils are working with their parks and rec departments and police to figure out how to support our blessed constitutional right to gather peacefully and support citizen activism in process. So there's a whole resolution, actually, that I'm going to give you. I don't have time to read it all, but it's obviously on First Amendment rights and some references and what LA's doing and Seattle and other people in other cities. We're all facing the same sort of mess. You know. So I'm asking you to be part of the 99%, permit the tents and reliable utilities, sustain their First Amendment rights. Which side are you on? Which side are you on? I'm asking you. So thank you. Do you have any questions or comments?
Ms. Courtney, thank you for...
For Parks and Rec and the police. These are references.
Now, I know a council member started the clapping. They were doing a great job with the hands. We get it. Perfect.
Parks and Rec, please.
And they'll, my citizens' assistance guys will take that. I do want to be very clear that how much we have appreciated the fact that there has been good communication between the police department and the Occupy Houston group and the movements among our square out here to Eleanor Tinsley Park and across to Tranquility have been orchestrated well, and we truly appreciate that. We hope to continue to have a good dialogue. Your points are noted. I'm not ready to make a commitment here today, but
you'd consider a resolution, Mayor? It's
this
election
is,
year.
This is not. No. We clear the chamber if you start clapping the hands.
Oh.
Perfect. We don't want to have a civil disobedience in here if we don't have to.
No.
Okay. Thank you.
Appreciate
it.
Any other questions, Council?
There's a. Okay. There is a council member.
Thank Park Calvin for Houston City Council at large position number one. And my rights have been violated because I'm the only Tejano and Native Houstonian on that race. And I was excluded from the debates. And I will file a lawsuit against the City of Houston, Houston Media Source, and we will take over this city.
Anyway, there is a... I don't know how much time we have left, but there is a council member in the queue, Councilmember Jones.
Ms. Courtney, I want to thank you for coming. I had a professor at U of H Law School named Bucky Buchanan who taught us Trust and Wills with all these songs. You just made me think of him. Councilmember Edwards, who was a predecessor to Councilmember Adams, always sings This Little Light of Mine because it is a very inspirational song. But I've got to say that one of the words that you said that just stuck out in my mind as you were speaking was that this is a peaceful protest,
mm-hmm.
and that we should support young people, and that you're not stopping business as usual. And then on the agenda, it says you want to talk about the flexibility of use of city parks and First Amendment rights. We received notice that, quote, there is a possibility that individuals representing Occupy Houston will attempt to stage a sit-in to disrupt today's public session. I was offended when I read that. It's really interesting when people come and challenge the status quo or say, hey, we don't agree necessarily with how you're doing stuff. People presume that you are bad people. They presume that you are bad people. And when you put that out there, that makes some people respond differently because you have a preconceived notion of what you think people are. You have been so respectful. You have participated in the process. I'm glad to see you here because sometimes I believe that we sit in this around this horseshoe and we haven't a clue what's going on with people who can't afford to come here during the middle of the day when they have to work and will lose their jobs if they miss their jobs.
Also get a clarification when you get something like that. That's not from us.
No, it did not come from you. It did not. Right?
Oh, okay.
Because government
so
is afraid
check the source. Yeah.
Of people that they're not used to. And I'm thankful to see you here. I listen to everybody, whether I agree with you or not, because that's why I was elected. Right? Because I can always learn something from somebody. And I hope to learn something every day. But I think people ought to pay attention to you. You have really great ideas. And if you want to come talk to me at my office, I'm happy to have you. I don't care if you actually live in a house or apartment or you're homeless. That doesn't matter to me. Because this city is made up of everyone. And truth be told, I believe that any society should be judged by how we treat the people at the bottom of the rung. At the bottom of the rung. And when you holistically don't listen to or try to blame the people for where they are, when the education in some neighborhoods is substandard, subpar, when the quality of life in some neighborhoods is substandard, subpar, when the quality of food people have access to is substandard, subpar, maybe they end up in places that society wants to pretend that they deserve to be. So I thank you for being peaceful.
Thank you, Ms. Courtney.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm here to address you regarding our situation across the street. As you already know, our fellow citizens, your constituents, are part of are acting in solidarity with a currently worldwide movement known as Occupy Wall Street, Occupy Houston, and what have you, standing in solidarity against corruption, favor brokering, and other unethical conduct that plague the political system on a national level. We're not a group of protesters who plan to disband after a few hours, but instead dedicated citizens who will stand vigilant until our grievances are appropriately addressed. As such, we've endured wind, rain, heat, cold, humidity, and mosquitoes, especially mosquitoes lately. To name just a few of the unpleasant things that we've had to face on a daily basis, because we don't believe that democracy is a spectator sport. Since day one, a city ordinance has prevented us from sheltering ourselves in tents. Tents are part of our protest and have already been allowed by large municipalities such as Los Angeles, and currently, the prohibition tangibly restricts our ability to exercise our First Amendment rights to assemble peaceably, despite rulings such as the 1984 ruling, I believe it was, Clark versus Citizens for Creative Nonviolence. I say this because that ruling is unjust, and in the words of Thomas Jefferson, if a law is not just, then it is not law. What I ask is that you kindly follow suit with Los Angeles and cease enforcement of this unjust ordinance. Please do what you know in your hearts to be right and act as protectors of our First Amendment rights. And thank you for your time. Although, also, I would like to throw in a few things. I think we absolutely would do well to have a Kroger in the Third Ward. However, I'm fairly certain that Kroger will do fine without any aid from our already ailing city budget. Moreover, on the issue of fair trade, I think it would be beyond morally bankrupt of us to allow, even through act of omission, the exploitation of our fellow human beings just so that we can save a few cents on coffee. Thank you.
Councilmember Jones.
Is your name pronounced Alessi?
Yes, my first name is Remington.
Okay. I'm going to call you Mr. Alessi. My mom raised me like that.
Oh, all right.
I don't know you well enough to call you by your first name yet.
I don't think I'm old enough for that.
But on the 380 agreement, thank you.
Councilmember Jones, I apologize for distracting from the central issue, which was the tents. May I find out what everyone's position is regarding the tents?
Sir,
so many people are willing to come out.
The time has been expired.
Yes, I appreciate that. And Councilmember Jones ate up most of my time.
I mean, if there's enough, I'll make a motion to extend. I don't know if there are enough of us. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Unfortunately, we're supposed to be in, there's got to be a certain minimal level of us. And some people, as you see, aren't here, so we can't extend your time.
Oh,
but I'll
I
answer the question
that.
The next time somebody comes up.
All right,
thank
certainly.
You.
Esteemed council members, my name is Burke Moore. I am an attorney, but I'm here as a private citizen and not as an attorney. You can rest assured I'm not going to quote case law to you, and I'm also not going to make demands. I have been working with Occupy Houston for several weeks now. And that is not as a legal observer, that is as an activist. I just happen to be an attorney as well. And I'd like to talk to you today about one very specific issue. And While I'll follow the rules of procedure, I intend very much to get something said about it. It's something that virtually every speaker of Occupy Houston has come forward. There has been a general assembly resolution passed authorizing everyone here to speak on behalf of this, though there was no specific speaker and no specific viewpoint other than we need greater rights to tents. So, again, I speak about an issue for Occupy Houston with some authorization, but not as an official representative. Now, we have come to ask for tents because we don't want this to be a matter of judicial activism. We believe that this can be a matter of activism on a grassroots level. And first of all, we would like to thank the city of Houston and everyone who has assisted. You all know when you turn on the news that there are arrests and tickets in various Occupy movements. In our city, we are very proud to say we have not had a single arrest of anyone directly acting for Occupy Houston or a single ticket. We take that as an ideological and tactical victory, and we intend to do everything in our power to keep it that way. We have complied with demands of police officers even when we question the legal basis for them, because we understand that our role is as activists on a grassroots level, not on a legal level. And we ask for a similar level of respect from the city. Which so far we have gotten on many issues. Now, originally we had permission to set up tents during a period of inclement weather, and we thank the city for that. However, once that period was over, even though the tents had been converted to implements of free speech, we were ordered to take them down. And without serious argument about the legal issues, we complied with the police conduct. However, this has been a serious detriment to us in our exercise of free speech. And we would like, first of all, for some kind of commitment by the mayor or by the city council, by any city council member here, that you do not support any action of enforcement by the police to force the tents down under any time. And in the alternative, we ask at least a clear statement from the mayor and any executive authorities about when the tents may be put up under periods of inclement weather, so that the policy that's already been followed will be clear and we can continue to follow the law.
Thank you. Your time has expired.
Chair recognizes Councilmember Jones. One moment.
Is there, I guess this should be directed at city legal, is there not a mechanism at the city whereby people can come, like I know, for example, with the Planning Commission, if you want to do something that's different that's been there, you can come and ask for variances or something. Is there not some mechanism that the city has where they can come? It seems to me if we allow them to have up tents in inclement weather, I would imagine attacked by mosquitoes might qualify as inclement. I mean, it seems like we want to protect our citizens and Houstonians. I mean, even if there are visitors here, we want to protect people. Is there not a mechanism whereby they can be able to do that on a temporary basis? And I believe the gentleman before asked me what my position would be on tents.
Response?
I don't have a problem with tents. I mean, the civil rights movement, the human rights movement was started by young people, and people did what was not ordinary, and I think people should have a right to make their views known, and that goes for everybody, whether I agree with them or not. So seems to me that we would be supportive of divergent views. So is there not a mechanism whereby they can go and try to get permission to use tents?
Response?
I'm asking city legal or somebody who is in a position of authority who can answer that question.
We have a city ordinance that prohibits it.
You know,
and we also have a city ordinance that prohibits staying overnight in a city park that is not designated for camping. They are actually exercising their First Amendment rights every time they violate the city ordinance and stay overnight in the park.
I might respectfully suggest, you know, we've gotten a bunch of good laws in this country when someone actually did judicially be active. One of the first things I learned in law school is that if you believe a law to be unjust or unfair, you say you're a lawyer. I say challenge. That's why we got seatbelts. Because someone thought that we should have seatbelts even though the car companies didn't and they sued. So I think the First Amendment is one of the founding principles of this country, and speech is not just words that come out of your mouth sometimes. So it's my respectful suggestion.
Hello, how are y'all today? Thank you for allowing me to speak. I initially didn't have a lot to say, but being here gave me some inspiration, and reading over the agenda for later today, I just wanted to discuss a few things. First of all, the Krogers, and was it Third Ward, correct? I personally don't understand why we would be delegating public funds to improve an already ecologically unfriendly infrastructure instead of using that money for, say, starting a local farming project. We talk about not having food there. I don't see why having a Kroger's, having a Kroger's there is going to help, but it's not going to help everyone. So that's my thoughts regarding that. I just had a few comments on the precedent being set on, by the decisions that are going to be made later today. I noticed that there was approximately $3.364 million that are potentially going to be allocated to public water funds, which I'm all for, but some of these have very stringent requirements for that. And there's also a $3 million program to give the police officers more cars. I don't have a problem with them having more supplies, but why are there not any stringent details on what type of cars they're using? Why are we not pushing that they use more ecologically friendly cars? I think that's kind of important. So you're setting a precedent, hey, we'll spend $3 million to clean the water, but we are stringent about how we're going to do that, and then we're going to spend $3 million to buy cars that are going to possibly pollute the air. So how does that balance out? I also know there's also, what was the other one that I wanted to discuss? So we are actually spending more to account for the water than we are at $3.766 million perhaps to account for the water. That's more than we're spending to clean the water, which is, like I said, it's just setting a bad precedent. It shows where our loyalties lie. The last thing that I want to talk about is the tents thing. I look around this hall here and I see words like justice, the people are the city, freedom and equality, and I wonder what these things mean to you people. Would somebody please grab my notebook? I had a little thing written up. Excuse me.
Sir, your time is running.
It's fine. I just have a few questions to ask you real quick.
Your time has expired.
Councilman Jones. Wow, I'm really excited to see. First of all, I love democracy. I love it. I'm glad someone came up and said democracy is not a spectator sport. You don't look, I don't mean to say anything about your age, but you look relatively young. I'm not asking.
20.
I think it rocks that you actually looked at our agenda. You would be surprised to know that an agenda briefing, it takes a whopping 30 to 45 minutes. You see all those numbers? You read about the water and all this stuff. I'm so excited to see you here. I hope more people pay attention, because you see, we do a lot of things that affect us locally. The thing that affects people more than anything is local government. I know people come out to vote for the president, but I've got to tell you, city council affects your daily lives. Obviously, we're stopping you from using tents, right? Who knew? Until you decided to use them. But this is great. You said you had some questions you wanted to ask. I'm curious to know what your questions are.
First of all, I want to thank you, Ms. Jones, for opening a rapport with us, not only inviting us to your office, but coming to our space to talk to us, which is something that I would love to invite everybody here to do. We are very friendly. So the three questions that I have for you guys, they're rhetorical questions. These are questions that you should all ask yourselves every day. First of all, who are you working for? Second of all, to what ends? And third, why are you qualified? So, like I said, there's no need to answer these questions verbally to me. Your actions will speak for themselves. That being said, I love all of you, and I hope to see more of you at the GA. I understand you are legally bound by certain, you know, bureaucratic things. So that's why we're inviting you to take direct action outside of, you know, the things that are binding you. Come join us. Come talk to us. Help us help you, and help yourselves help us. So,
what bureaucratic things are you saying? I mean, I'm trying to figure out what you think we can't come there. Why?
Oh, no. I don't think that you guys can't come here. I understand that there are things that bind you guys from helping people in general, thanks to the legality.
Like, who said that?
It's just things that are written in you know, legislation. Like, there was a gentleman up here who had to someone else instead of, yes, like you've been very open. Yes, come to me. Come talk to me, and I will do what I can. But instead, we have this whole philosophy, well, go to the correct place, and they might be able to help you. We're all kind of bound, if you understand what I'm saying, by a lot of rhetoric and a lot of legalese, as some people would call it. I mean, the precedent has to be set by our leaders to put human rights issues above fiscal issues, and that's the precedent that has to be set in every action and everything that you make. If I'm going to pay taxes, if even a fraction of those taxes are going to be doing something that I am morally object to, why would I volunteer for that? Why?
You said some very profound stuff. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, esteemed council members. I'm here today to introduce y'all to our program, Operation Clean Sweep, which we came up with as we realized that money has become the impediment to any progress globally. It seems like anytime you hear that something can't be done, it's because we lack the money to do it. So we've come up with this Operation Clean Sweep, where we'll clean the downtown grid. We did an initial project this Saturday, in which we picked up approximately about 300 pounds of trash off the city of Houston streets, and we are going to have another one on November 13th, where we have volunteers come out and meet us at Tranquility Park at 9 a.m., and we divided up the 35 streets and sent them down the streets with a lobby dustpan and a broom and a garbage bag and a pickup. Mainly cigarette butts, but all trash. And just like know, like let y'all know we're doing this, and maybe we can get y'all support.
Councilmember Jones?
Thank you. We'll sign up. My office will.
All right.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Matthew Sullivan. On behalf of myself and as a participant of Occupy Houston, I thank you for listening to me with an open mind. I am here to respectfully give you, the council, and the city of Houston at large, an opportunity to help Occupy Houston and the Houston population at large gain increased access to clean water for drinking and other uses. Services regarding public access to water are sorely lacking in this city, especially in the downtown area. I speak for more than myself when I state that clean, fresh water should be made more readily available to the public here in Houston. My first request is that you help me get in touch with a city representative who can give me more information in this regard. My second request is that you entrust our movement with a water key so that we may readily access the non-potable water source in our camp. We have four volunteers willing to personally take responsibility for this key. I myself am one of them. I was able to make a service request to check the water that comes out of our water fountain at Tranquility Park. This slow flow of water is currently Occupy Houston's main water supply. I request that it be tested for the benefit of all who drink our water downtown. If that test has been done already, I request the results and a review of it. I also request access to a water spigot serving clean drinking water so that we do not have to spend valuable time holding down the button and holding on the hose to fill our containers. There are many people in this city who are in need of clean water. It can be very difficult for certain parts of the population to fulfill this human right. We will gain access to clean water. Will you help us? That's all.
Councilmember Noriega.
This is a question for the administration. Is there a water fountain that works over there? Do we know? Can we check into this? Because really, water is... It's not an unreasonable request.
We can check, Councilman. Thank you.
I appreciate that. One of the things that I read one time that was one of the most interesting facts that I ever ran across was what a difference it made in the world when women didn't have to spend their whole day looking for drinkable water. They talked about Africa and India and that kind of thing, but that young women and women with families spent most of their time looking for water, and the thing that crowded out the ability to get an education was that hunt. And so the first thing that women did when they didn't have to spend all day looking for water was to go get an education. They could go to school. So water's pretty basic. I think we probably need to handle that. And if we have a fountain that's not drinkable, we need to deal with that as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Councilmember Jones.
I was going to say the same thing as Councilmember Noriega. My office can help you follow up with that to find out what the city's position is. I don't think it's an unreasonable request either. And if for some reason the city's position is that it is unreasonable, I'll try to figure out why and just try to work with you. So I guess I just need to find out who we need to contact. Thank you.
Thank you. That's it, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Stoffer, to be followed by President Joseph Charles.
Hello. My name is Jamin Stalker. I am a registered voter, participant in Occupy Houston, and have lived off and on in the city of Houston for about 4 years. I would like to begin by saying thank you to the mayor's office, local law enforcement, and the city of Houston for your exemplary role in support of Occupy Houston, Occupy Together, and the entire global movement. It is my understanding that more than anything else, it is our environmental conditions that create the behaviors we witness throughout society. For instance, the forced inability of HPD officers to express their humane feelings while on duty in regard to the conditions in society in line with just doing their job. It is also my understanding that for decades we have relied on big government to provide us with the solutions to the inequalities we face as a civilization. In joining with the Occupy Houston movement, I have experienced firsthand individuals who are fed up with the status quo and have assembled peacefully to create ways to discuss the problems we face and work towards solutions accessible to everyone. For example, our recycling and solar energy efforts that have allowed us to show sustainability in practice, not just in theory. As a permanent occupier, I am committed to working with the city, state, nation, and the international community, including the 1%, to help usher in a society that will allow a high standard of living for all the world's people, void of any subservience or servitude. In closing, a learned society has no need to be governed or controlled. And I urge you all to come see for yourself how this movement is more so about human evolution instead of revolution. Thank you.
Clutterbuck?
Thank you, Mayor. I wanted to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Stocker, since he's our last speaker on the subject, and all of the other of his colleagues who've appeared before us today. I know we've been discussing here how much we enjoy having you here in our chamber. I wanted to express to you my personal appreciation for your interest in our work here at the City of Houston, and that we've noted and noticed your peaceful assembly, and that doing things in a very Houston way of talking about things together and trying to come up with solutions. And I just wanted to applaud your civic energy, and we welcome you back. Thank you.
Councilmember Jones.
Thank you. I think imitation is the highest form of flattery, and I really liked your words. It's about evolution, not revolution. Thank you.
Thank you.